Very good morning to all of you, and I'm particularly happy that the theme of the symposium is on science education, and I would like to share my experiences in research and what we expect from the students in for future. We have all witnessed unprecedented development of technologies. All of us remember in 30 years back, in even as early as 90s, we used to submit our manuscripts by post. We will wait for 3 weeks or 4 weeks for the acknowledgement, and only then we will send a reminder and so on. Today, everything is done online, and the same day, we complete all the formalities and so on. It's all because of this rapid development of technologies. I remember at National Physical Laboratory in the 80s, when we bought a computer, we needed a big hall and several kilowatts of electricity, and now all of us carry a computer in our pockets. All the functions we can perform using a laptop. Unfortunately, all these technologies have been developed abroad. I know in my area is superconductivity and cryogenics, superconducting magnets, and I know how far behind India is now today, not comparing with US or Europe, but comparing with Asian countries like Korea, China, and Japan. So something has gone wrong with our policies, and it has to start from the education stage. We have to inculcate the spirit of getting inside the technology development and so on. So this is my, I just express my views through these slides. I worked for about 38 years in National Physical Laboratory, and another 16 years I have spent with Nuclear Science Center, which has a new name now, Inter-University Accelerator Center. Thoda pani dena. Ji sir. Acha ye change kis se karna hai? Acha okay. So why education is important? You see, what is the wealth of a nation? Not by printing the currency notes. Wealth comes from, according to me, either through farming, farmers who grow products from the earth, or an industry converts a raw material into a finished product. That is our wealth. Similarly, if you turn an illiterate person, uneducated person, into a educated youth, it's again like converting a raw material into a finished product, which will convert a liability to assets. So education is extremely important for us, and technology will come only through the understanding of science. So to catch up with our neighbors, science education needs innovative techniques to motivate young students to involve themselves in technology development. In my opinion, book knowledge may not be sufficient. A student must understand the concept, the experiments and demonstration best way to explain concept where the students will never forget, and they should assemble kits and verify physical laws by themselves. Fortunately, internet and videos are available, and the student have a good opportunity and can benefit greatly through this internet. But new problem has come now. Students face very tough competition and have no time for creative work, like making electronic circuits and gadgets. And I find now that 11th, 12th students hardly go to school because most of them go to coaching, and therefore they miss that opportunity to do experiments in the school. Well, research in university I mean, I feel that our research work is not technologically oriented, because the research with the university, it varies widely from the quality of the research, because our universities, by and large, are not very well equipped because of poor funding. Only institutes like TIFR, IC Bangalore, they have very nice research facilities, and they do very good basic work, not so much of technology. Individual professors sometimes are able to get funds from the funding agencies, but then the projects many times last till they stay in the university. The moment they leave or retire, there may not be a taker for that particular instrument, and it's difficult even to maintain them. Therefore, university, I feel, they do very good work. They get students trained, get them PhD degrees, publish papers, and all that. That is their mandate, no problem. But research-wise, universities are not funded very well. In fact, some of the universities got some accelerators recently for nuclear research, but they find it very difficult to maintain them because the infrastructure in our university system is extremely poor. Even though the best technologies, you know, most of you are familiar, they emerge from the universities in US, Europe, and Japan. Now, we have a large number of research centers and national laboratories in the country. Under the organizations like DAE, DRDO, ISRO, CSAR, DST, and DBT. Have they lived up to expectation? This is my observation. ISRO lived up to the expectation and beyond, could execute Chandrayaan and Mars missions, send satellites from other countries, multiple satellites in one launch, and developed cryogenic engine, which is very important for the last stage. And it has a very bright future. It has an pride to us. DAE did excellent work, and that made India a nuclear power, all of us know. But in my opinion, probably we expected much more, because still we are dependent on foreign technologies for our nuclear reactors, and particularly fuel. DRDO, I feel, has been left behind. India, by and large, fully dependent even today for their strategic war machines, fighters, nuclear submarines. We read every day some stories about the failure of the Arjun tank or other fighter and so on. So DRDO also has a very good network of research laboratories, and very good scientists are there, very good work they are doing, but ultimately this does not find entry into the armed forces. Materials are developed, paper published, awards given to the scientists concerned, but hardly they are used it for making devices and used by our armed forces. But still they provide vital support systems to the armed forces, guiding hostile borders and treacherous weather. DBT, I am not very familiar, but it's a very important trust area internationally as well as nationally, and is heavily funded all around. I have no more information, but still we have to hear breakthroughs and new discoveries about viruses, vaccines, and so on. DST is our funding agency. It supports many research projects, very small projects for research fellows, large projects for the group of scientists, and mission mode projects have been also been sanctioned. But there are problems in DST as far as I know. These thrust areas are defined and forgotten after some years. New areas are defined and funding starts there. People buy very expensive equipment. That is really a pity for us. When we started low temperature in 1952 in NNPL, most of the measurement system were built by us. Today, nobody makes any system They buy black boxes from abroad. For example, PPMS, you can find in every room, and very expensive instrument. And if you ask a student how do you take the measurement, they say, I put my sample palette in the sample holder and take a printout. What is the method which is being used for the measurement? They do not know most of the time. Then there is a poor monitoring of the projects, whether they are doing good or they are not doing good work under the project. There is no good monitoring mechanism there. Then the accountability is a problem in India, most of the places. The PI, there is no accountability. If the project fails, there is nobody to question him or to help him out. What is the problem and how can you solve it? We have a team of experts, they will come and help you. There is no such mechanism. And so much so, even if a project is successful, the final report goes to DST, it's kept in the records of the DST, no communication with the PI, no feedback whether DST is happy with this project, you are successful. So this is the next step. Why should I submit a new project? I should be asked to do it. If I have succeeded in a project, they should tell me. Now, or they, even if they ask me, I can suggest, I can go a step further now. For example, we made an MRI instrument and then magnet. No, we never heard what is to be done for next high frequency system and so on. So there is no response whatsoever from DST after final report is submitted. It might be filed somewhere and it may be collecting dust somewhere after a few years. Then CSA has a very big conglomeration of about 40 laboratories. And I know most of the laboratories, the projects are based on individuals. I have some interest in certain things, so I keep a project, and then it is successful, they can present it before the research councils and so on. But the laboratory has its own objective. Whether I continue to be there or not, the project should not be stopped if it is a laboratory project. There is no such mechanism in CSIR labs. And if you go to the CSIR organization, I doubt very much whether they have a national priorities where they should work and where they should not work at all. Whenever there is some new discoveries made, all of us jump into that. High temperature superconductor is an example where everybody started doing it. And when the project was stopped completed and stopped, nobody knows. So there are problems with our funding agencies as well. And in between, CSIR changed its mandate. It also started giving degrees. As a result, a scientist who did his MSc or PhD 20 years ago, how do you expect him to teach a subject to the students and award degrees? So universities are there. You improve their conditions so that good research work can be carried out there. And CSIR National Lab, from my point of view, should concentrate only on technologies and basic research which is required for those projects. Then, many times for our convenience, we blame industry. That industry doesn't collaborate with us. They always want to make profit. But then, to make profit is their religion. Who will bail them out if they incur losses? Like Government of India, every year they bail out Air India and so on. It will not happen with the private industry. So the point is, we have to develop confidence. We don't trust industry. Industry doesn't trust scientists, because a scientist can demonstrate one experiment in a lab, but when it goes for production, there is an intermediate stage which is missing, always missing. I run a machine, demonstrate it for half an hour, and the moment a person or the director of the lab goes out, it may stop, it may not work, 24/7. So that is the problem, and there is no point in blaming industry. Unless you make a system, use it widely, and certify it by the organization concerned, only then industry will take up. So what is the remedy? These are all problems I have talked about. One is that we should have a national list of systems to be built within a reasonable time in the country. So all the projects which are sanctioned by different funding agencies, they should have coordination, because now you can submit the same project to 2-3 funding agencies under different titles and get it funded. So it is all duplication. The same type of work is being done by a number of groups in the universities. So the coordination between all the funding agencies like DST, DVT, DRDO, BRNS and CSIR is needed. Today's same project can be funded by different funding agencies. Now, with basic research and then we have applied research, according to me, they are not totally exclusive. One can pursue both. We did this experiment at NPL, and I don't see there is a clash between basic and applied research. NPL, we had a two-prong approach. All research fellows were given basic problems to complete their PhD work. And we ourselves, all the permanent staff, we used to do applied research to develop, for example, we developed multifilamentary superconducting materials, wires, and within the lab facilities, without buying anything whatsoever, we could produce 80 meters of multifilamentary wires within the lab. The next stage was to give it to BARC, who can upgrade it to kilogram level and kilometers level. Then, building of the superconducting magnet, we started making magnet because we needed them for the characterization of our materials. And we decided not to buy magnets, import magnets. We'll buy the wire, which is not produced in the country, and build magnets. And this we continued. And there were several applied nature building of a cryogenic container. Then we developed some insulating material characterization facility for the cryogenic industry, which used to send their materials abroad for characterization and pay very heavy fee. So these are just an example. I will tell you, these are, for example, you see large number of 7-8 superconducting magnets, it produces a field of 7 Tesla. And then the complete system, and this is a, in between there is a magnet which can be directly dipped into a container and take a quick measurements, no need for any extra cryostat. And then we continued on and we moved to another technology which is called niobium-310, very difficult. But we built in the country, and even today, I made this first magnet in 1990, and still, it has not been tried by other lab, and it has an Indian record of 11.5 Tesla. So these things can be done within the lab, provided there is a policy that we are supposed to do this. This was a NMR magnet, and we took this challenge, even though we had no experience. But then we tried hard, and we could, because here the homogeneity requirement is very, very high. And this was for demonstration, 100 megahertz magnet. And this runs in a persistent mode. Persistent mode means, if you know the MRI, where the whole body goes in, this is superconducting magnet, which is cooled down to 4 Kelvin temperature, that is dipped in liquid helium. That is my profession, and we had been working with helium, and NPL was the first place in Asia to have started low temperature physics. So this was built, but then again I say, from this we could have gone much ahead, we could have tried MRI, but there was no communication from DST whatsoever. This was a very successful experiment. A spectrometer was built by one Professor Mathias in IIC Bangalore, and the two worked better. Then there was again application nature. When everything failed in HTS, we were asked whether we can have some industrial application based on conventional material. And this was my suggestion, and BHEL was the coordinator. So we helped them, provided consultancy to BHEL. And this was again very surprisingly the first experiment This has 200 kVA superconducting generator, again first time in the country, and it worked very well. This is the high gradient magnetic ore separator, again my proposal which was accepted, and then this was built an automatic system for the, you know, this kaolin clay which gives whiteness to your bone china pottery. So it comes from this high gradient magnet separator where you get rid of the magnetic impurity, mostly Fe2O3, and then the whiteness which is used for paper industry and the pottery industry. So these things could be done. Then I moved to IUAC. Again we started this application area. Luckily this institute builds most of the system by itself. Nothing, we buy only component, but all our accelerators and that low temperature linear has been built within the institute. This is another magnet, superconducting magnet, 7 Tesla, which was built in 2006. And this is, again, the first time in the country, 6 Tesla room temperature superconducting magnet, which is cryo-cooled. Cryo-cooled means the whole magnet is cooled down to below 4 Kelvin by using cryo-coolers and not by liquid helium. So there only what you need is just a power point for the cryo-cooler compressor, and then everything works, field is produced, and this was made for 6 Tesla. This is the latest that has come from the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. We have been, this is a consortium actually, which is coordinated by Samir, and CDEC, Trivandrum CDEC, Kolkata are involved, and IUAC has been asked to build superconducting magnet and the cryostat, zero boil off, that is you fill helium once and forget, for years together it will remain cool. Any helium vapors, they will get condensed back into the liquid. And let me tell you, in these magnets, they run in persistent mode. What is persistent mode is, you make it, what is a magnet? It's a coil in which you send a required current. Now, if you pass a current through this coil, you produce a magnetic field and you short circuit the two terminals. The super current flows through the magnet forever till it is cooled to that temperature. That is persistent mode. So there is no power supply. You will see MRI or NMR magnet doesn't have a power supply. The supplier starts it, charges the magnet once, and then takes away the power supply. And it continue to run, because superconductivity means you can pass a large current without developing a voltage, zero resistance. So that is supercurrent which doesn't dissipate. But then the homogeneity of the magnetic field is extremely difficult than the gradient coil. So this is for us a challenge, but simulation has already been completed. And the winding and the design of the magnet is very, very complicated. But then, design is just ready, and we are placing order for the bobbin, and then winding machine is somehow not available in the country, the precision we have. So we'll see what can be done. We have enough experience in building magnet. So in summary, I can say that all that you have to teach to students, that this desire to develop a thing, what Mantriji has also said, that we should develop in India. And we start with a big bang, and then midstream somewhere we lag behind everybody and we forget about it. This has happened in many areas of our research. I'm not decrying any organization. They started very good work, and then, but somehow we couldn't, you know, sustain that. So if the, your teaching way is such that students get interested in building systems, that will be one very fine moment for us. Thank you very much.